Thank you for staying with us. I still have my guest with me, and we're talking, we're just getting started with the conversation, actually. The budget recurrent, what we have as non-debt recurrent expenditure, there is an increment from last year, and this is largely due to the minimum wage that we have coming in. But the new wage adjustment and proposal for other sectors like the army play a role, but is it wise? Shouldn't institutions be self-funding at this stage? Should we continue to make budgetary allocation? Doesn't that affect, you know, service delivery?
Service delivery in what sense?
In all the sectors, because if you keep sending monies to the, you're budgeting their salaries, yeah. Basically, that's half of the money for the army. We have 91% of whatever the budget is for servicing personnel costs. Shouldn't institutions be self-sustaining?
So, I mean, what we find with the proposed budget, the appropriation bill for now, is like the repetition of all that's happened structurally. And it's been a long history of that fiscal indiscipline in place. And then a budget that's structurally built over time to remain the same. So, I mean, getting to that level of innovation, if one's in terms of allocation and the likes, you know, yeah, would require a lot of, let's use the word political will or a cultural change per se, you know, and it's going to hamper deeply on the structural development of how the budget is being built. So, for example, you have a situation where you have about the revenue side, the non-debt revenue side, non-debt recurrent expenditure on 4.8 trillion naira. I mean, that's just to tell you simply that it's still a cost-driven budget, you know, so to speak, that the cost of governance is still as high as it has always been every year. So when you say budget is probably a budget of a sustainable growth or whatever the theme is for this year, it doesn't necessarily depict what that ideology should be, because it's just a repetition of what has been. And so for there to be any form of change, of any form of institutional change in the budget development, there has to be a change of that culture, you know, that cultural process in developing the budget and the numbers and the allocation and all the likes.
Your thoughts?
I mean, it's like you said, it's a bit of a ritual, and to be honest, I'm not very hopeful. I did just some rough numbers. So if you look at 10.3 trillion as against roughly 8.8 trillion last year, it would look like, oh wow, it's a leap. But then there are a number of mitigating factors that we've got to consider. So like you said, first of all, it's the fact that we are still concentrating heavily on recurrent expenditure as against capital expenditures that drive development. In order to change that, it's either you will significantly boost your revenue base such that you can then budget more of the increase to capital expenditure, or you cut the cost of governance. Now, either way, there are very difficult decisions to be made, right? So I don't see that happening. Now, let's do some sort of a comparison of our budget with other countries. You find that we are significantly under budgeting. Do you know that, for instance, this budget at 10.3 trillion comes to just about $171 per person per annum? So if you break the budget down to per capita budget, it's $171. That's 54,000 naira per person every year. Break that down to per day, it's 142 naira that the federal government is spending on every Nigerian citizen, assuming that our population is 198 million, right? Now compare that to a United States of America, where the budget per capita is $16,000, as is 171. South Africa is $1,700 per capita. Even Ghana, just our small brother's neighbor, small, with all apology to them, you know, small in size and all that, is $400 per capita. Very small, but still far better than us, right? So something has got to give. This budget will not take us anywhere. We've got significant infrastructure deficits, whether you want to talk about power, Whether you want to talk about roads, is it the rail networks, is it health, you know, just name it. The country is grossly underserved infrastructurally, and we will need to spend trillions and trillions of dollars over the next couple of years to catch up. This budget won't do it. So, you know, this business as usual routine, it's pretty much a cut and paste thing, right? So if you look at all the budget heads, the breakdown, just when they release it, you'll find, in fact, I am very certain, you will find some figures are actually identical to last year's budget. And it was identical to 2017. And that's the way it's been.
So what is wrong with the people that put this together if there is no shift from the year before and the year after?
It's business as usual. It's unfortunate, but that's just a reality. It's business as usual. We have to remember that regardless of the political leadership that sits, you know, over the government of the country, there's a civil service, there's a bureaucracy that drives, that's the engine room of the government. The bureaucracy has not changed in 20 years.
Okay, you're sounding all gloomy. So let me see if I'll put a little positive spin on this and ask, what is the highlight in this budget proposal for you this time around?
Well, the budget seeks to introduce some level of tax reform, and which feels quite impressive. I mean, I use the word feels intentionally because it's still an assumption, right? And it's yet to be approved by the...
you're talking about the 7.5% agreement in VAT, right?
Yes, and then there's also a finance draft bill that went ahead with, along with that appropriation bill. So it's also assumed that that bill will bring about some level of assumed fiscal equity and the likes. But then my question is, how do you want to achieve that fiscal consolidation when you've not even achieved a level of fiscal discipline? You know, it's like you want to reduce your spendings or cut down on debt servicing and the likes, but you're not ready to reduce your own cost of governance. You know, so it's like clashing interest and the likes. So for me, like he mentioned earlier, I just want to emphasize a bit on something. With the current state of budget we have, there are questions around how that size can improve, if it should increase or not, and all the likes. But with the current budget we have, even if we doubled those numbers, as it were, you know, it's like a situation where you are trying to fetch water with a basket, right? So you're literally going to fund institutions that are grossly ineffective to deliver on an economic agenda. I don't know if you understand what I'm trying. So regardless of the budget amount, you know, and if you have institutions that are effective, it means that those monies will pass through a pipeline where, you know, the objectives will actually be delivered at the end of the day. So you have a budget that doesn't deliver, then you now have an implementation that is almost less than 50% yearly. So this speaks to the fact that there are already institutional bottlenecks waiting for, it seems like the budget is like a dead on arrival, you know, situation. That's why you can't really count for as much impact. Now, I want to also speak on something as regards growth. You know, people talk about this movement from 0 to 1% growth, and you know, there's also a conversation around this budget bringing about sustainable growth, as it were. In the light of contemporary economics, you know, for developing nations like ours, if that growth or financing growth does not lead to a sense of inclusion, or does not reduce the employment gap, or does not improve standard of living, or reduce the cost of living, then it's not growth in the sense. I don't know if you get what I'm trying to say. So what are you trying to fund? You're trying to fund a situation where it's like, how would I put it? SMEs and the business environment or the individual in the society is literally bearing the cost of that increased budget. I don't know if you get what I'm trying to say, because now the impact is on the VAT, right? You have 7.5%. And what that simply means is that for businesses, majorly the medium and large enterprises, they'll be paying way more than they used to pay in terms of taxes. And that would, in turn, the cost will be passed on to the final consumer, either of that product or the employee in that organization.
Yeah,
so it's like a cost cycle, per se, that does not really feed into what the essence of growth should capture.
Yeah, my question was going to be that you talked about the National Assembly hasn't reviewed that and accepted that it should go ahead to become law. So what about the place of the concern of Nigerians, like you were expressing, the added cost to people? People are saying this is too much for us. Do you think we can deal with this? Does it mean that the people's opinion doesn't count, that these VAT will become law, well, in spite of the resistance against it?
It's quite unfortunate that we're in an environment where policies are being made without, let me use the word, adequate consultation. Or if you say adequate consultation with the right stakeholders who will be directly affected by those, or even if they are being made, is there a political will to, you know, to adopt these policies in light of what the people need the most right now? I've mentioned several times in several places and several articles that what Nigeria needs basically is creating incentives enough to expand that tax net, not necessarily the tax rate. The tax net, that means the number of persons who are encouraged to pay taxes at a particular percent. If we can do that rightly, it does take a period of time. People will be willing to, you know, pay higher for taxes over time. And not forgetting that the social capital trust has not been included in this scenario. So you want people to pay taxes at a higher percentage where you yourself as a government have not given them the reason to believe they should do that, the reason to comply. So they should be... there should be an incentive for compliance, but the focus should largely be on expanding that tax net, encouraging people to pay taxes, and improving the efficiency of tax collection, and then closing gaps in the economy.
Yeah, I'm told we have such a little time. We've barely started this conversation. I'll just go ahead and ask you this particular question that's of concern, based on the security situation in the country. Now, the military and the police would spend 91% of their budget on personnel costs and recurrent expenditure. This will force security agencies basically to make part payment for much needed security gadgets. Should they have more for capital expenditure, considering the critical state of our security?
Considering that we're actually at war, you know, because that's our reality. We have a war that we're still campaigning at, in the Northeast.
Well, okay.
Yeah, I mean, that's a reality.
In a part of the country.
Yeah, and we are at war. I mean, it doesn't look that way to us down here, but you need to visit Maiduguri and, you know, Borno State, and you know what's going on. So considering that, the defense budget for me is a bit small. Now, the recurrent side of it is not necessarily a bad thing, because that's the component
it's necessary,
of that.
But they need more.
Yeah, they need more. Yeah. But given the limitations, the revenue limitations that we've been talking about, right? So it's got to be, so which one do I prioritize, right? So we need to pay the soldiers their welfare in terms of, you know, salaries, work conditions and all that is also critical. It's almost more important than equipment and all that. So I don't have much of a problem with that rather lopsidedness of you know, of the distribution of their budget. I wish it could be better. But let me also quickly say, because I think we're running out of time, that you are looking for positives. One major positive for this budget is the attempt and the effort, and I hope they get it right, to change the cycle, to return.
Yes, that was what I was scribbling here. I was going to ask you, is there any relevance of that?
Absolutely.
Because there seemed to be a whole lot of noise made about it.
It's absolutely critical. I've always been screaming about this, you know, all the years back, that you can't run a budget cycle that is different from your fiscal year. Our fiscal year as a country is January to December. You can't run a budget that runs June to July, because what that does is it throws all sorts of spanners into the planning process, both for the private sector, investors. How do I know, you know, the impact, for instance, of the money that I've brought into the country over a period, you know, when most times the budget cycle is always skewed and you're always going beyond, overshooting the fiscal year end, you know, and all of that. So this, if they can get this right, and it looks like they're determined, then it will be one major win. Very small looking, but extremely fundamental, you know, to our future development.
Oh, quickly, I want to also get your thoughts on the purchase of fuel. The amount being proposed for this is about 9 billion Naira for fuel, diesel to power, give us electricity and all of that. For someone on the streets like me that don't really understand, you just hear that amount, you feel it's a whole lot of money. Wouldn't that be a little better expended in ensuring that the power sector is, I mean, move to the power sector to make sure that we don't have any other excuse other than to improve it?
Well, frankly, the challenges of the power sector are way more complex than just financing.
They're a bit more complex than that. And you know, it's a value chain that runs from the disco, from the genco disco, the transmission and all that. So it's way more than just, and even that amount, they will still need way more than that.
More than
you
that.
You know that. So
no, they already have a budget for them.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, I mean, that delivering power itself is way more than just budget or the financing question. There are stakeholder interests that needs to be aligned. You know, there are a lot of pressure points that need to be sorted. And so much more things than just the budget. Like, I've always said this, you know, when you have the budget the way it is now, especially for Nigeria, and then you don't have, there's still an institutional effectiveness gap, then it means that those monies will just pass through somewhere that they would never come out on the other end. I didn't even forget. So, yes, power, yes, the amount might sound so much. They may even need more. They may need to borrow way more and all that. But if you still have an ineffective institution, the value chain around delivering power and all that is still so much, you know, dice is not so clear. There are still, you know, stakeholder interests that needs to be sorted and all that. It just means that the money will keep hanging in different places and it will never get to that point where it's actually delivering for value.
Okay, I asked you about the highlight of the budget for you, but I want to ask you your summary thought of this budget. Do you see us getting real outcome? One of the APC chieftain talked about it not being a scam and not really benefiting the ordinary Nigerian. What is your opinion?
You mean PDP?
National Publicity Secretary of the APC.
All right, fine. I wouldn't call it a scam. You know, a budget is a serious document, right? And without it, the whole country can't plan. So it's a decent effort. We, you know, the fact that there is some sort of drive to try and grow the volume, because the amount is important, you know, so that's a good thing. I'm concerned, though, there is one revenue head there that just sticks out for me, 3.7 trillion naira as other revenues. You know, I mean, it's bigger than any other revenue head. It's bigger than oil revenues and non-oil revenues.
Clearly stated.
You know, so where they're getting that from? Signature bonuses and all that, perhaps sale, privatization sales and all that. But that's a huge chunk. So let's wait and see. Like you said, there's a lot of ifs and ahs and buts about whether this budget will achieve some sort of development or not. And we can only hope that they will get it right.
That's a good note to end this segment. Thank you very much, gentlemen, for sharing your thoughts.
Thank you.
All right, we'll go on a short break, and when we return, we'll be speaking on the latest in the case of the fight against insurgency, Boko Haram. Just stay with us.